everybody. Welcome to Reckoning Live, Episode 2. My name is Kevin Michael Johnson, also known as Haven on the Reckoning boards. You might notice that I am bald. Well, yes, this is a part of my Halloween costume. I'll go ahead and get that out of the way. Many of you might know a gentleman at 38 Studios named Kieran, or that's at least his gamer tag. His name is Charles Dane. I decided to dress up as Charles for Halloween this year, and here's a little picture I'll show you so you can take a look at that. It was good. It was good. It kind of freaked him out. He looked like a deer in headlights, but, you know, job well done, I would say. So anyways, now I'm bald, and that's that. So moving on. Thanks for joining us for today's show. We're really excited to have you guys here with us. We're sitting here live in the BHG common room, so we might have some special guests walk through. Who knows? But with me here today to start off is Jess Folsom, also known as Muse on the boards. You guys might be quite familiar with who she is. Thank you for joining us,
Thank
Jess.
You. Hi, everybody.
We're really glad to have you.
Thanks.
So, Jess, I wanted to bring you on and have you talk a little bit about what's going on in the community, maybe some things that have happened over the last month. We've had a pretty packed month.
The forums have been getting busier and busier, as have the Facebook community and Twitter. It's all kind of growing over the last few months. We've definitely got a lot of cool stuff going on. Every week we do community content. We have the weekly Q&A that we do on every Wednesday. Every Friday we do a weekly recap on Thursdays, kind of jumping around here. We do the interactive story, which allows everybody to choose the direction of the story. So we hope everybody will come and vote every month. Once every week on Thursdays.
Yeah, absolutely. That, I want to jump in there. That's actually been a really cool thing. If you haven't heard what we're doing, it's kind of akin to Choose Your Own Adventure, but we're doing it in the Reckoning game, of course, and with a unique story written by the narrative team here at BHG and with help with Jess as well. And so please join us every Thursday, right?
Yep, every Thursday. And then we also have the Destiny reveals on Facebook every Tuesday and Thursday. And the Inside Reckoning, which we're doing at least once a month, and that's taking a deeper look at certain aspects of the game.
Yeah, exactly. We had two of those this month. We had one with Marty Stoltz, the head of cinematics here at Big Huge Games, and another one with the narrative team. It was Andrew Ossian, Tom Murphy, Eric Capone. Yes, sorry. Blanking here. But we also had Tom and Andrew here at the last Reckoning Live as well, so you guys might be familiar with who those guys are. We also had a couple other big things happen, right? New York Comic Con?
Yep, New York Comic Con. And we showed the Prismir Troll statue for the first time. And we'll reveal more on how you can get your hands on one of those.
Yeah, I think we have some cool fancy pics for you. So take a look at some of that while we're talking about that. It's a really cool toy done by the team at McFarlane Toys, obviously based off of the Prismir Troll from the Reckoning game. And we're really excited to tell you how you can get a hold of that at some point. We haven't really divulged all the information about it, but we just wanted to give you an idea of what the thing was and get you excited about it. So stay tuned for more info on that.
Yep.
What else,
and,
Jess?
And we also had the panel.
Yes, that's right.
Creating a World Worth Saving with Ari Salvatore and some members of the Reckoning dev team. Boy, that was Ian, and I'm going to forget names now.
Yeah, Andrew Ossian was there as
Andrew
well.
Ossian, yep, and Steve Denuser from 38 Studios.
That's right. And we actually recorded that. We haven't told a lot of people that. We recorded that panel, and we're going to be editing it up for you guys so you can take a look at exactly what was said. There were some really interesting tidbits there. So.
I guess lastly, we have more forum and website goodies on the way every first Monday of the month. So November 7th will be the next batch, so definitely stop on by the Reckoning forums for that.
Yeah, awesome. That includes some, well, it's always varied up a little bit. Sometimes wallpapers, sometimes avatars, sometimes some other secret stuff. You'll just have to stay tuned for it. So
so beyond that, in the coming months, definitely stick around, and we've got more cool stuff coming your way on website, forums, Facebook, Twitter.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Thank you, Jess.
Yeah,
that's
thank
very
you.
Cool. So obviously this particular Reckoning Live, we're going to be talking about Destiny and Fate. So if you haven't seen it already, we had a trailer drop about a week ago, I would say, on the subject of Destiny and Fate. It's another one of our Heroes Guide videos. We wanted to have you take a look at it right now, and then we'll bring on our special guests, Ian Fraser and Will Miller, to talk a little bit more about the Destiny system and the Fate, Twist of Fate system, and exactly how that's going to impact your play in Reckoning. So enjoy the trailer. We'll see you in a little bit.
Rated M for mature. Amalur needs a hero, but the Fateless One's destiny is unwritten and ultimately will be shaped over time by the decisions you make.
I do not know what you are. Still, it wasn't her fate to die here.
These choices affect your hero's journey and help create a distinctive experience every time you enter the world of Amalur. As your hero becomes more experienced, you have the ability to improve disciplines of might, finesse, and sorcery. How you choose to enhance these will unlock certain destiny cards that affect the power of your hero's abilities and may influence your approach to encounters you have along your quest. From the fast, ranged, and melee-based duelist to the seers who can teleport and are experts at magic, destinies are about who you choose to be. But you are not shackled by these choices. You may, over time, become a might-based brutal conqueror, then decide to transform into a powerful warlock. Some heroes may develop a unique hybrid of disciplines and skills, or even become proficient in all three. The possibilities are endless. For the right price, Fate Weavers are helpful allies in discovering your hero's destiny.
What brings you to this sacred place? A prayer? For the weaving of your fate.
Along the journey, the Fateless One will visit other Fate Weavers who, for a fee, can help him modify what type of hero he wants to be by wiping the slate clean. There are other ways to affect your destiny. When your hero successfully completes major quests, the player may be rewarded with a Twist of Fate card, but these rare cards are not so easily obtained.
When you meet Ventrinier, be careful. He may want to kill you the second time around for good measure.
Depending on how your hero completes quests and forms allegiances will impact what type of Twist of Fate card will ultimately be granted. You hold the cards of destiny that will alter your hero's journey through the treacherous world of Amalur. How you choose to play that hand will guide you on a unique adventure beyond your imagination.
What's up? Welcome back. Hope you enjoyed the trailer. That was Destiny and Fate, our hero's guide to Amalur. Also, I want to introduce our special guest with us here today. First is lead designer Ian Fraser. You all may know him as Tiberius.
Howdy.
The man with the awesome beard.
Thanks for joining us, Ian.
No problem.
Also with us here tonight is Will Miller, systems designer here on Reckoning as well. Thanks for joining us, Will.
How you doing, guys?
It's really good to have you with us. And really excited to hear what you have to say about Destiny and Fate. So let's jump right in. Well, actually, before we jump right into Destiny and Fate, I want to hear a little bit about how you guys got involved with this project. What brought you to Big Huge Games, and maybe what did you do a little bit before your work started here?
Right. So I came from a mod background, did a lot of mods for different games, especially Dungeon Siege. I spent a lot of time doing mods for that. I got in at Iron Lore Entertainment as a level designer. I worked there on Titan Quest and on the Dawn of War franchise. Kind of shifted into a gameplay design role or systems design. And eventually ended up here at Big Huge, where I've been working ever since.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Very cool. How about you, Will?
I actually started out with our friends at Firaxis Games, which is just right down the street from Big Huge, making strategy games, so the Civilization franchise among them. And Transition to Reckoning was an interesting one. Designing role-playing games is a lot different. So I've been in the Maryland game development community ever since I graduated from college.
That's pretty cool. So what's the climate like around the studio these days? Obviously, you guys have been in a pretty big crunch period. What would you say the general feeling is around the studio? How's morale? How are you guys doing?
It's a mix, honestly. Like the programmers are still crunching hard because we're here at the very end and trying to get the game ready to actually ship out. Most of the rest of the team, is things are starting to calm down for them because it's the point where we're not messing with art or design things at this point, really. I think the mood is generally pretty good. We're pretty excited to have the game after all this time finally actually get out there on the shelf.
Yeah, everybody's really keyed up, and maybe that's just the candy we ate this weekend. But you can, it's palpable. You can really feel how excited everybody is to get this game out the door, and we all know that it's a solid product.
Yeah. That's awesome. I'm excited to obviously see how things unfold and finally get to show all the hard work you guys have been pouring into this game. It's quite remarkable. So anyways, let's move on to the topic of the evening, Destiny and Fate. Obviously two really loaded words when it comes to this game. Mm-hmm. Let's talk a little bit about Destiny and this idea of the Destiny system and what that means for the player experience. Where did this come from? What exactly is the Destiny system and what is it, what is its implications to the player?
So when you start off the game, fictionally, you're dead from the get-go. Like in the opening cutscene, already, you're shot. Not literally shot, but dead.
Yeah.
So at the end of that, the player wakes up in a pile of corpses and has no recollection of how he died or why or who killed him or anything like that, but he knows that he's back. And so at that point, we're saying that your fate, your destiny, was to die, like everybody else's. Sooner or later, you end up dead. But then you came back, which no one's ever done before. And because of that, your fate, your destiny is screwed up. You don't have one anymore. You've kind of come out the other side, and now there is no place for you in the tapestry of fate. Mm. Because of that, we have a lot of different systems and story elements that are kind of tied into the fact that you are completely disassociated from that tapestry, from that weave, ranging from the fate shift kills we do in combat to the destiny system itself.
That's great.
It's one of the really cool systems in the game because it's so closely tied to the narrative foundation. You know, Amalur is built on this notion of fate. All of the religions are built around this. All of the culture is built around sort of a deterministic outlook on life. And when the player comes back, all of that starts to break down with everybody that he or she interacts with. And the Destiny system is the systemic manifestation of that idea.
Yeah.
What that means mechanically is that, like, you know, most RPGs, one of the first things you'll do is choose a class and decide if you're going to be a paladin or a rogue or what have you. Coming from just a systemic perspective, we said that's a problem because players come in, they have to make a blind decision. Mm. You know, I might come into this game and I want to be a rogue because I played the rogue in some other game and I thought it was awesome. But Will played a rogue in a completely different game and has a completely different set of expectations for what a rogue is. Mm. So if we both choose it, I might be happy and he might not be. You know, because they don't know what a rogue in Reckoning is going to be until they've played it.
Sure.
So we wanted a way for the player to come in and not have to make a decision blind at the start. We get to experience the different kinds of play styles and approaches to the game, and then choose, and then be able to keep choosing what kind of class they wanted over the play experience.
Yeah.
And that's how the Destiny system works. After you get through the tutorial, basically, you're going to level up, and then based on the points that you have invested into our three different trees of might, finesse, and sorcery, the kind of different themed abilities, you're going to unlock Destinies, and it's a series of these kind of tarot card things that you can equip, take upon yourself, and say, this is my class now. So as you progress through the game and you unlock more and more of these, you can constantly be shifting that class based on what you find to be the most fun in the game.
That's a pretty remarkable system. I always like to know where these ideas come from. Is there any sort of root for this idea? I mean, I understand the frustration of not wanting to be sort of, not having a blind guess at what mm-hmm. your play experience is going to be like, but was there any sort of influence behind where the system came about? Or?
I mean, I think from the problem we were trying to solve perspective, that was one of the biggest foundations. Sure. We had a list of things that we thought could be better in RPGs. And we're RPG fanatics, so we have our list of criticisms and complaints. And one of the big ones was that having to make blind decisions. Like, do we put points in charisma or dexterity? I don't know.
Yeah,
is dexterity useful in this
game?
That's
so hard. Yeah, that's such a hard thing.
You know, especially you'll have ones like a lot of RPGs have, you know, put points in strength to increase your inventory limit. Mm. And that never seems that big of a deal until you're halfway into it. Then you go, oh, I hate this game. Why didn't I put points in strength? So, you know, we wanted to avoid that problem.
Right.
In terms of influences, I think the big influence was a lot of Eastern RPGs, actually. A title system is something you'll see in a lot of JRPGs, which usually is purely just a title, a name that you can attach to yourself and change out over the course of the game. We thought that was cool, but we wanted to add a systemic component to it and make it like the thing that defines you, that really gives you your actual stats and bonuses and powers.
Right. I mean, it all sounds so complex. Like Will, as a systems designer, how do you begin to make sure all this works? Like, it just seems like there's a lot of moving parts, a lot of opportunity for, you know, someone to switch their playstyle in the middle of the game. Like, how do you even balance and keep all that? How do you keep that working? The magic.
Well, as is the case with lots of systems in Reckoning, not just the Destiny system, because the game is so big, we have to rely a lot on telemetry we get back. The game reports a lot of data about how you're playing and the decisions you're making. So that's one tool we have. Another tool is, you know, we have a great QA staff. We can go to them and say, you know, how does this feel to you? Give us some feedback. And then, you know, we are huge RPG fans, and so there's a lot of sort of intuition as a designer that you can cultivate by playing RPGs a lot. So we rely on a lot of things to make those balanced decisions.
actually have a team in QA we call Team Raptor that's especially dedicated to not like looking for bugs as such, but playing through the game like a normal person would. You know, like, here you go, here's the controller, try to play through as a rogue from, you know, for 100 hours or 50 hours or what have you. And then based on that, we'll take their feedback and we'll use that to help us balance a whole lot of different things, but including Destiny's. So as Will said, QA team has just been incredibly valuable in helping us look at all the different ways you can play this game and try to balance them across each other.
So Team Raptor, where does Raptor come from? Anyone know?
It's a long story.
Okay. We just hope they don't.
Too long for Reckoning Live.
Yeah.
All right, cool. Well, all right, so talk to me a little bit more about the nuts and bolts here. So I get a new Destiny, I equip it. What are some of the expectations I might have as a player for what that would mean, like, in my play style? Does that just mean I become stronger at, like, you know, dealing melee damage, or does it also come with some other perks that might be unique to that particular Destiny?
Well, in any RPG class, you would expect some statistical bonuses, and you're going to get those with Destinies. You're also going to get sometimes bonuses to non-combat skills, things like, you know, persuasion or stealth. But there are also certain things that unlock as you progress up the Destiny chains that fundamentally change the play style. So one of the greatest, the best examples we've got, one of them is Blink. So if you equip a Destiny that has some magic component to it, right, one of the mage mixed Destinies or the straight mage Destiny, you get Blink, which is replaces your standard role with a teleport. And that changes your moment to moment. And we're real big on sort of making these systemic things that can then feed back into that moment-to-moment experience, and that's a great example of one of them.
Oh, that's awesome. Very cool.
And you can further flavor it from there. Like, if you're a pure mage, you start off having just the straight-up blink that lets you teleport. If you keep investing in unlocking higher tiers of mage destinies, you get a point where that teleport gets an ice dot added to it, so you can actually freeze guys and slow them down as you teleport through them.
Oh, wow.
But if you were to do, like, a mage-rogue hybrid, you would unlock a poison blink, poisons enemies. And because you've got a lot of points in that rogue tree, in the finesse tree, you've probably, odds are good, you've got equipment or abilities that help you become more effective with poison damage.
Sure.
So all plays together.
Poison blink.
Yeah.
I like that.
What about some of the other top tier ones? Anything cool that we want to?
Yeah.
Oh, we've got a couple of them. One of the cool ones is, in my opinion, my favorite Destiny actually is the Jack of all trades Destiny. And this Destiny is cool because it's a sort of a noob mistake in RPGs to kind of evenly spread your point allocations along a skill tree, you know, evenly distribute across might, finesse, and sorcery. But in our game, we actually make that workable for you. We reward you for that. Of course, you're not going to be able to unlock the top tier abilities in any of those trees if you distribute like that. But with the Jack of all trades Destiny, you get the Master of Arms ability, which lets you use all of the cool weapon specials across all of the different weapon types in the game. So if you really like the combat in our game, you're really good at it, that's a fantastic Destiny to equip.
Very cool.
Yeah.
That's awesome. Well, let's transition a little bit here. Let's talk a little bit, actually, before we transition, did you guys have a favorite Destiny? You said Jack of all trades. What about you, Ian?
If I had a type of Destiny, I'd probably say, so like Jack of all trades is more of a flavor of Destiny. There's actually like six different kinds of Destinies that all fit within that umbrella. As far as the kinds of Destinies, I think the fighter mage hybrid are probably my favorite. But if I had to pick just one, I would actually pick Shadowcaster. It's the top tier rogue mage hybrid. It just gets some really cool abilities like Dread. It's a really interesting hybrid. I like the name Shadowcaster. It's got a really cool, like, I like the art on the card. It's just a little bits about it are a lot of fun.
That's very cool. Okay, so Fate. Fate is the other main topic here. Now, there's another system in this game that's sort of tangential or runs alongside the Destiny system called Twists of Fate. Can you explain a little bit about what these are and what they mean, especially for the player experience?
Yeah, so a lot of our quests in the game, some of the major quests, like the main quests and the faction lines, have points where you are altering the fate or the history of the world in some substantial way. And when you do this, first we want to make sure you know it, and second we want to make sure you get some sort of systemic reward for that, because this is a pretty big deal. Whether it was a thing where you had to make an exclusive choice between two options or three options or what have you, or if it's simply sort of a milestone of, I got to this point in the story, and at this point in the story, I made a big change. So a Twist of Fate is how we do that. It's presented like a tarot card, much like the Destinies themselves are. But unlike the Destinies, you don't equip a Twist of Fate. It's a package of bonuses to this, that, or the other thing that you have on you for the rest of time. And again, a lot of them are exclusive. So like if you're playing through, the House of Ballads faction line, you know, and you choose to end it this way versus that way, you might get a different twist of fate that has different bonuses, and either way, you're going to have that for the rest of the time.
And they're all bonuses. I mean, twist of fate may have negative connotations, but in our game, all twists of fate are good. They're just different kinds of good, depending on how you negotiate a particular quest.
I mean, they're all over the place. They range from I do better ice damage to I have a bonus to every finesse ability that I have to I get 1% faster XP. Like it varies depending on what the twist is.
That's interesting. I'm also so intrigued by this sort of metaphysical approach you guys are taking to the idea of fate in the game. You talked a little bit about this earlier, Will, that everyone in the game is sort of fated and locked into this idea of fate. Now, I'm just so curious how that works. So when you enter something like Reckoning Mode, which we've talked about a lot, you talk about how people's fate are unraveling, and you're the one, the unraveler of fate. I don't know. It gets me thinking, sort of like about Back to the Future, and how like if you twist one thing, then everything else unfolds. And I mean, is your narrative team working to kind of keep all that like all the threads of that like
the threads of fate,
the threads of fate, like
I'm sorry,
and, like working together? I mean, it just seems even that seems complicated from my mind, from a story perspective about what the implications of this player means as a result of all this.
It's definitely tricky, especially knowing that the MMO comes, 2,000 years later, and whatever you did presumably has ramifications well into the future. I think the narrative team has had their fair share of pain dealing with this whole concept, but they've also had a lot of fun with it. It gives them an opportunity to have, choices that matter, with a lasting repercussion, in this case a twist of fate, or actual story changes because of that. I don't know, it's interesting. It's also given us hooks into some of the other systems, actually, outside of even the narrative, and outside of Destiny's and Twists of Fate. Like, in combat, those fate shift kills, you mentioned the guys start to unravel, right, when you're in Reckoning Mode. The idea there is that you are killing these guys in a way, a time, a place, a whatever, that they weren't originally intended to die, by fate.
Yeah.
They were going to die eventually, but not this way. Because of that, there's a little bit of leftover fate energy from that guy. It's like they have their thread of fate, and you're kind of snipping it short. So you're like, I'll just take this little extra bit, just leaving around here at the end. And you gather that fate energy, and when you have enough of that, that's when you can do those special attacks. Go into Reckoning Mode and then do that crazy explosion.
Awesome. We have a kind of an interesting top-tier ability for the mage. You equip pure mage Destiny at the highest level, you get what's called the Echo of Fate. And whenever you you kill an enemy, you get a chance to sort of splinter off his fate into a separate entity that will fight alongside you. It's very cool. Wow. It's like having a temporary familiar with you that is from his fate.
Yeah. That's so cool. That's really neat, just seeing how the narrative plays into something like that. It's very, 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 very cool. All right. Well, I'm trying to think if there's anything else on these topics before we turn to Q&A. Anything else about sort of Destiny, fate? Anything, I guess we don't want to really talk about what these Twist of Fate bonuses consist of, right?
I gave a couple little examples earlier, but going into the details, probably a little too spoilery at this point.
Yeah, let's leave it. All right, well, gang, we want to get your questions about Destiny and Fate, so we'll take them one of two ways, via YouTube comments, that's fine, or also by Twitter if you want to throw out a tweet with the hashtag ReckoningLive. Any questions about Destiny and Fate, we'd love to answer for you.
Also, if you want to delve more into Kevin's baldness, we can help with that as well.
Yep, that's a pretty simple thing, actually. Just shave it off.
Just pick it.
Yeah. Rikita, you said? Rikita, thank you for your question. Is it possible to drop back down to a lower Destiny if a higher Destiny has been chosen? Is that the correct question? Okay, how about that?
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you can drop down. If you're a kind of fighter mage, you want to drop down to a lower tier of fighter mage, you can. You won't, because why would you downgrade to a thing that was lesser version of what you have? What you will sometimes do, or have a reason to do, is downgrade to a lower tier of a different kind of Destiny.
Oh, I see.
Like I might have unlocked a tier 4 fighter mage, but I might in this particular instance or just in general want to be a tier 3 pure mage, which I may have unlocked already at that point, so I might want to downgrade to that. For the purposes of whatever I'm currently doing.
Ah, very good.
Right, the bonuses that you get for lower tiers of your particular Destiny sort of, in most cases, fall along with the higher tiers. Mm. So you're going to have those things that a lower tier would have plus some at a higher tier. But that lateral move, we don't penalize you at all. You can do that whenever you want, provided you've unlocked the Destiny.
And there might be some times contextually where that's what you want to do. Like, I mean, I mentioned earlier the mage teleport, getting that ice upgrade. Let's say you're finding something where putting an ice dot on it actually is beneficial to it. It makes it heal, or it just is completely ineffective with it. That might be a time you want to downgrade and actually use the one that doesn't have ice.
Ah, very cool.
R-M-R-K-L.
Okay, N-R-M-R-K-L. Can you give a last name to your character?
As long as you can fit the full name in the character limit, yeah, it can be two words, that's fine.
Okay.
You can also give last names to your weapons, too, I think.
That's true.
Oh, yes, that's true.
If you craft them, you can name them weapons and armor.
You have your sword named Bob Marley.
That's right. You can do that.
It's fantastic. So, yes, you can have a last name, and you can also name your weapons with a first and last name if you choose. Thank you for your question. Anything else over there, Jamie?
Make a Michael J. Fox hammer.
Michael J. Fox hammer. Yeah, I like that.
First, middle, and last.
Ooh, yeah.
I think that fits the character limit.
Yeah.
You can tell we've had a lot of fun with that one.
Everyone's getting
bad buffering.
Yeah, YouTube. We're just, I don't know why it's having so many problems this time. We had a great stream. Sorry about the troubles, everybody.
A lot of folks here are downloading Battlefield 3 right now. It's just killing our internet connection.
Exactly. All right. Well, if there's no other questions, maybe we'll...
Maybe you can those questions we'll answer at the beginning of this.
Yeah, we can do that. Sorry about the bad buffering, everybody, if you're catching this. Not intended and not expected. So we'll examine YouTube and try to figure it out. Yeah, everyone's having trouble. All right. Well, do you guys got any questions for me? Questions for Jamie?
It's like an interview now.
I know, right?
So what made you want to work at Big Huge Game?
Yeah, exactly.
I'm good.
We're getting the game done. Yeah. It's looking great. Like I said before, all of us are high energy right now, and we're so excited to get this game out there and show it to you guys.
One thing that has nothing to do with Destinies or Fate, but I'll say it anyway.
Yeah.
A lot of folks have been asking in the forums about what our sixth faction is. They see, like, you said there's six, but there's only five on the website. I'm not going to tell you what that is right now, but I will tell you that there is an answer, and it's coming.
You heard it from the man himself, everybody. It's coming. So just be patient.
There really are six.
That up. Yep. Okay, well, thanks, guys. Thank you for joining us. Thank you for your time. I know you're busy, busy guys, so thank you for taking your time out to be here. I know that the fans appreciate it. I appreciate it. You guys are awesome. Keep up the great work.
Thanks.
All right, so that's it for us, Reckoning Live Episode 2. Thank you for joining us. If you want to connect more with our community, there's a bunch of ways to do it. You can do it through Facebook, Reckoning the Game. So that's facebook.com/reckoningthegame. We do a lot of stuff on our Facebook page. We have our interactive story. We have Destinies that are being revealed, and we also have a weekly Q&A that we connect you with through the Facebook page as well. If you want to watch our Twitter, we have Reckoning Game, or at Reckoning Game is our Twitter handle. We'd love to see you on there as well. And that's pretty much it for me. So we'll see you at the next Reckoning Live, Episode 3. Thanks again for joining us. Talk to you soon.
Thanks.